Everybody, welcome to a very happy Sunday. Just want to say thank you to the orchestra. As we're trying to do that, we will be singing from Sacred Songs and Solos number 242. Thank you to the orchestra, especially Alus for the flute solo, then followed by Magnify and Glorify. Then I will not forget thee that has just been rendered. For those of you that are watching us over the internet, this is the Apostolic Faith Church, and this branch is in Peckham. You are very welcome, as we welcome everyone that is seated before us as well. And you will find our contact details on the website in case you wish to come here and worship with us in person. For today, it is not too late. We have just finished the preambles, and we are going to go into the main service. So if you live close by, please make sure you can make your way and find us, but if not so, we pray that you will listen attentively and the Lord will bless your soul. We want to continue, as I've mentioned today, singing from Sacred Songs and Solos, and Brother Mike Wallaby is our song leader.
Thank you. take 555, 555, SSNS 555. At this moment, we want to tell God to remember us.
Amen.
The world is going through a lot of changes. Things are happening. But if God can remember us, it will be well with us.
Amen.
So we want to sing this song prayerfully. Yes. That we want God to remember us.
Amen.
Organist. Once we have surrendered all to Jesus, he's able to take us through.
Yes.
Despite the life situation, God is there for us.
Yes.
And he will take us through.
Yes.
590. The orchestra will introduce this one for us, and then we'll sing it joyously. All of us will sing the first verse, and then the second verse is going to be by only the ladies, and then we are the third verse, the men, and all of us will come in at the chorus. So first, all of us, second ladies, we come in at the chorus, third, men, and then we all come in at the chorus. We sing it heartily after the introduction from the orchestra.
Thank you.
Our song before prayer is going to be 641. We sing verses 1 and the last, 641. We sing the first verse and the last verse standing, after which we shall be led in prayer. 641, we want to listen to the organist briefly, and then we sing verses 1 and the last standing up. Shall we rise? I am trusting the Lord Jesus.
Are going to pray together. I heard in the news yesterday, Nigeria was mentioned along, there were four countries, was mentioned along South Sudan, which is the youngest country in the world, was mentioned along Somalia as one of those countries that is going, so many people are going to die of famine unless drastic steps are taken. And we know that there are some other countries in the world. We heard of the war in Iraq, and the war in Syria, these trouble spots in this world. So we just want to pray for world peace, that God should send his word to these regions, and let the word of God galvanize every soul.
Amen.
And that let there be peace.
Amen.
Jesus is here to bring, came to the world to bring peace. Yeah. Let that peace be enveloped all over the world.
Oh,
Our scripture reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, starting from verse 1 to 11. Verse 1, 2 to 11. 10. 1. Moreover, brethren, I will not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and the sea. 3. And did all eat the same spiritual meat? 4. And did all drink the same spiritual drink? 4. They drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. 5. That with many of them, God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in their wilderness. 6. Now these things were examples to the intent we should not lust after evil things, as they also lusted. 7. Neither be ye idolaters, as were some of them were, and as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink, and rose up to play. 8. Neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed, and fell in one day 23,000. 9. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted, and were destroyed of serpents. 10. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured, and were destroyed of the destroyer. 11. Now all these things happen unto them, for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world will come.
People who are searching near and far for something that will satisfy their soul. They say, I want a pleasure that is real and will not mar, a joy that lasts, a peace that will console. So they are searching, searching, seeking in vain, searching for pleasure or deliverance from pain. Cease from idle searching, dry your every tear. There is no need of searching, Jesus is here. Now others in our universe are crushed by grief and pain, bent low neath wave of weariness and woe. They've sought in earthly pleasures that their health they might regain, but never once the Lord that we have known. So they are searching, searching, seeking in vain, searching for pleasure or deliverance from pain. Cease from idle searching, dry your every tear. There is no need of searching, Jesus is here. To those who seek true pleasure and deliverance from their ills, to those whose hearts are thirsting for relief, we say the blood of Jesus bring you pleasure that will thrill, and peace is gained through fervent heart belief. If you are searching, searching, seeking in vain, searching for pleasure or deliverance from pain, cease from idle searching, dry tears. There's no need of setting. Jesus is here.
1 Thessalonians chapter 4. I'll just read verse 1. It says, furthermore, then we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that as you have received of us how ye ought to walk and to please God, so ye would abound more and more. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 1. I'll probably read again now that it's on the screen. Furthermore, then we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that as ye have received of us how ye ought to walk and to please God, so ye would abound more and more. This was Paul here addressing the Thessalonian church. He was telling them, reminding them of what the holiness teachings that they received of them, how to walk and to please God. And as they do that, he was kind of assuring them of what they knew, that they will abound more and more, that they will live the more abundant life in Jesus Christ, that life of victory, that life which they will enjoy. I guess when it comes to pleasing someone, I guess a lot of us can relate to, you know, pleasing someone. I mean, if we think of maybe a marriage, I remember when I was courting Remy, of course, many years ago, and I guess from my side, I would want to do everything to some extent to demonstrate that I am pleasing to her, and I guess she would want to do that on the reverse too. You want to kind of just make sure you're pleasing to someone. And oftentimes, when you want to catch someone's interest, someone's heart, you would not want to do it on your own terms. It's either going to be mutual or it's going to be on their own terms, because what you want is a positive outcome. And let's imagine the legacy we receive if God can say that he's pleased with us and that maybe I or you has brought joy to God. That somehow our conduct, our relationship with him has brought joy to him. It means somehow we're pleasing to him. Imagine a parent, maybe after much investment over the years, and you just feel the child who probably came through that parent gets the time when they want to leave home, perhaps maybe to be on their own, or perhaps maybe by virtue of marriage. And there is something that registers within you that feel that, look, I feel my mom feels pleased about me. I feel my parents feel very pleased about me. A lot has gone into that. And that's something I'm sure we cherish. Now, as we kind of try and unfold the Bible reading or the scriptures we've read, I think the bottom line was the Israelites ended up not pleasing God. They ended up not being pleased by the God who loved them so much. And there was a problem there. And if you and me are to learn, are to pick up something from that, I think it will do us a lot if we can learn from their mistakes. If we can learn from their mistakes, it will be very, very profitable. I mean, someone said, learning from your own mistakes is smart. If you make a mistake and learn from it quickly, you're smart. And he says, learning from others' mistakes is wise. If we can learn from another person's mistake, it's wise. Not learning from either is foolish. And it was Eleanor Roosevelt, the first lady of one of the past American presidents, said, learn from the mistakes of others, you can't live long enough to make them all yourself. So it was a wise saying that learn from the mistake of others. That if you feel that, you know, the saying of these days says, let them make those mistakes, they will learn from it. I don't think that's wise. I'm not saying it's wrong to make mistakes, especially kids coming up, perhaps maybe when they stumble a few times. That's relative. But generally, when it comes to life, I think it's wiser to learn from other people's mistakes. They said, even you would not, it says you would not live long enough to make them all yourself. So because you've learned from it, you will not make those mistakes. So it's important we can learn from them. So as we really try and take some time to build on the Sunday school we've learned this morning and kind of look at the way that same, the issue, the scenario, or the issues that Israel faced were presented to the Corinthian church because they were facing the same problem. And I guess we of the church of the last days, we the end time church today are in the same situation. And may God help us to really learn from their mistakes. I think it will profit us a lot. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. We'll just read the first four verses. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. It says, moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. I mean, pretty much what Paul was saying here is, as you kind of, I'm trying to create a kind of a relationship to the problems you are facing. Let me try and show you the mistakes of what our ancestors have made. And that will then help you to see the predicament you're in, and peradventure, you may actually be wise and learn from those mistakes. That's what he was saying. He was kind of enumerating the blessings. The blessings that the same Corinthian church had enjoyed, the spiritual advantage they have, was the same the Israelites also had in those days. He said, how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea. I mean, I'm sure, let's try and a minute just cast our minds maybe so a few thousand years back and put ourselves in the position of the children of Israel, when they suffered for 400 years, you know, where they were under bondage in Egypt. They suffered so much. And all of a sudden, deliverance came. They were delivered, and it was such a mighty deliverance. I mean, the joy. I mean, let's try and picture what would have happened during the Passover. When, you know, after the Passover, when they were all coming out of Egypt, you know, the spoils that were there, I'm sure they were elated. They were so joyful. They were so happy. Some of them will almost be floating in air.
Yeah.
Some of them will be imagining, how can this be? Some of them perhaps couldn't even ever imagine that they would taste freedom. But when that freedom came, they were thoroughly elated,
yeah.
Thoroughly excited.
Yeah.
I think the point I'm making is, it's very easy to assume that they were not saved. But they enjoyed what we enjoy now. They enjoyed the joys of true deliverance,
yes.
True freedom.
Yes.
And that's why it was warning them. These people went through the same. Like a lot of us here have probably gone through that experience. And he said, they all passed, they were all under the cloud and passed through the sea. Imagine the pillar of cloud by day, the pillar of fire by night. The protection of God around them.
Yeah.
God knew they were going through the wilderness, but he assured them that, don't worry, I am your God.
Yes.
I am going to protect you. I'm going to be your all. They felt that protection. They could feel it. They could touch it. And they were so joyful about it. They were extremely happy for what God. And the Bible said, you know, they all went under the sea, which was a type of water baptism.
Yeah.
As they went there, the same way, it's saying, people who've been saved also, as a way of actually signifying to the world, went through water baptism.
Yeah.
Saying, these went through this. Not only that, they said they did all eat the same spiritual meats. I mean, it's very easy. We belong to a church that we could call a holiness church. And we're so grateful. We're apostolic. We are. And we're a holiness movement. A church whereby maybe not many in this current world do exist that really want to go the holiness way. And it's a big, big legacy that we're so thankful to God for. And we can say, we're going to have Bible study on Wednesday, by God's grace, some have it on different days in the week. The same Sunday school book is what we digest. We spend some time Monday through Thursday, Friday, or Saturday, and then we come together, break that word of life, share it together. We sit under the same word of God as different people share it, and we use the same Bible, if you like, to divide this word in our homes, to our children. So the Bible is saying, it's that same meat that we're eating. Mm-hmm. We're sharing of that same sound word of God. Mm-hmm. So don't let lose track that whatever we may pride in, the Israelites could pride in it. But yet, they had some issues, some big, massive issues. He said, and did, in verse 4, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. Imagine, the Bible says that even that rock that followed them, all the miracles they experienced, the manna, the quails, you know, that God gave them daily, and the rock, you know, when the water they drank from the rock, they were signifying that Christ was following them even in the wilderness.
Yeah.
Though they may not know, but Christ was there following them. They enjoyed all that. It's more like the testimonies we give of the greatness of what we enjoy in the gospel.
Yeah.
We enjoy all that, and we say so much about that. But you can't then imagine in verse 5 when God said, but with many of them, God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Said, in spite of that, imagine God addressing us as a church and say, I mean, God forbid, God says with many of us, he is not pleased. Despite the fact that, yes, he can attest that he's giving us something sound, something gracious, something glorious, something we can, you know, we can say so much about. God said, but with many of them, he was not pleased. And we know that out of the whole adult population of Israel, only two survived. Only two made it to the promised land. Only two of them made it to it. Which means it's not enough to be under sound doctrine. It's not enough to belong to this church. There's a bit more deeper than that. There was something more that God was asking or wanting from the children of Israel, which they actually fell short of, which was a big blessing. So we thank God for the gospel. It's a blessing. It's a privilege. People like me that, you know, perhaps grew up in a Muslim home, didn't have a clue what Christianity was all about. And all of a sudden, not just coming to Christianity, but to really come into a church like this. I mean, I can be weeping all day long in excitement, in appreciation to the mercy of God. If we see a lot that's happening, you know, out there, although we don't judge, we don't do whatever, but some people, when you begin to feel, we'll be so grateful that God has given us what he gives. But if God can then say that within that confines of what we are, with many of us, he's not pleased, I don't think that would be a good statement. But I want to talk a little bit about what I call the man in the middle syndrome. You know, oftentimes, there is nothing wrong in having a spiritual mentor. There's nothing wrong in having a godly mother, a godly father, godly parents, or perhaps maybe, you know, godly pastors, godly ministers, godly Sunday school teachers, or whatever. But the problem Israel faced was the man in the middle syndrome. God was using these people, the Moses primarily was used, so that Israel can actually be able to understand God directly. But they prefer that Moses, you be the spokesman. You stay there. God, when they came before Sinai, They felt that, look, no. God is too holy for us to come too close. God is too pure that we'll rather tone it down a little bit. And the way to tone it down is, you know, when you talk about when you have a third party, sometimes things can be distorted along the way. When you've got that direct link, then you have no excuse. You can't say this or that. There's nothing wrong in having those godly people to actually help us and break it down. But they did it because they did not want to get close to God. They found it just feeling that God, no, Moses, you go, get it all for us. And when it comes to us, we're happy with that. That's okay. And it's possible, really, to say, yes, I cherish my mom. You can say so much about your grand. Some people may be their grandparents. My gran is such a godly, sweet woman. You're happy about it. You cherish it so much. But you prefer that contact with God to be your grandmom and God. Then you can sap it through your grandmom. Whereas your grandmom is doing all she can to give you that direct link to God. And that may be the problem. That was the problem Israel was facing. What it took to walk with God, what it took to actually establish and develop a relationship with God, Israel was not ready, generally. They said God wanted to write that law on their hearts. That was the intention of God, to write it on their hearts. But when they saw the thunderings and the lightnings and the quakes and everything, that even Moses exceedingly quaked. Even Moses, the man of God, exceedingly quaked. But he was ready to still walk with God. Yeah. But they said, Moses, you can dare to do, not me. You can dare to be a Daniel, not me. I will go only thus far and no further. And that landed them into all sorts of problems. And the problem with this is piggybacking on the faith of someone can be very dangerous. Can be very dangerous because what happens is the moment that person is out of the way, your true character is exposed. Yes. The moment anything happens to that person, you find some people whereby they've got such so godly parents that the moment something happens and they're taken out of the scene, they just go down, completely down. Maybe that's the last time they're in church, or maybe that's the last time that Christianity will appeal to them. Whereas when their grandmom or when their parents were alive, they enjoyed it all. But there was a problem because their true character were being masked, being covered by their parents. So it appeared as if they were pleasing God, but there was an issue. That is the reason why I think someone contributed in Sunday school and was giving a lot of credit to our church. And that's one thing I enjoy about our church, is the fact that we do all we can to kind of present you directly to God and leave you there. That's why when we talk about the altar benches, we don't, you know, kind of elevate the ministers or the pastors. We just kind of try and present everyone to God because the children of Israel ran into that problem. They ran into God. Moses was trying to get them to God, but they said no. They said, well, if that's your permissive will, okay, we'll walk that way. And all sorts of problems actually happened. Now, the reason, when we go to verse 5 of our text, said, but with men, so verse 6, that's 1 Corinthians 10:6. Now these things happened, these things were our examples to the intent we should not lust after evil things as they also lusted. Can we see the problem now? Their problem was those evil desires were kept coming back. They had a tendency to lust, to want to go back. And that was their main problem. But because there was this great man of God in front of them, it was a no-no. Mom shouldn't hear that. Dad shouldn't hear that. My dad will kill me. My mom will kill me. Or my pastor will, I shouldn't. But in the New Testament era, really, the Bible says he wants people to worship him in spirit and in truth. It's something whereby you absorb that understanding of God directly on a one-on-one. You're not piggybacking. You're not actually saying, hey, it's my past. That's why some people quote, my pastor said, or my this said. When there's nothing wrong in saying that, but the real issue is God wants to relate to you on a one-on-one. Yes. That is God wants you to be able to say, this is my God. Yeah. God, I want to please you. I want my life to be a blessing. Yeah. I want my life to be a sanctuary. Make me a sanctuary. Tried and true. Pure and holy. That is what God wants. But if you prefer that, okay, it's a great church, but let other people take that center stage. And I can then use a kind of a third party thing. That is dangerous. It can't be okay. In the secular world, for example, we do things, for example, we transfer risks to a third party. Maybe you've got, I work in IT, we've got servers and things like that, and we may kind of get some third parties to kind of take care of it. The reason why we do that, apart from their experience or their expertise, is when something goes wrong, that risk is transferred to them. At least they are the ones now responsible. Although you're ultimately responsible, but at least somehow there's a bit of a, it gives a bit of a cushion that at least I can blame them and they can take care of it. That may work. There's nothing wrong in that. But spiritually, when you hold all your risks on that third party, on Moses, Moses went now to the mount. He went there. When God was only using Moses to reach the children of Israel, the moment Moses stayed, as we heard in Sunday school, stayed there for a few days, it became a problem. How, what's wrong with this Moses now? Because everything they knew was through Moses. They didn't want to have that direct relationship. Okay, what does Moses say? What does my church say? What does this say? That's all they wanted. And the moment Moses went, then their real person came out. The real thing about them, they just called Moses, Aaron, come up. Wait, what has become of this Moses? He's gone for several days. Why this? Up, do this. Of course, we may call Aaron a politician, but of course, his main problem too was he had a problem with his relationship with God. Yeah. It wasn't there. I mean, it's good to look at the external manifestation, which is fine. But before it gets that external, before someone can become political, there's been an internal problem. Yes. His walk with God was questionable. Yeah. He had a problem. He had already been exhibiting the traits of the flesh from within. So the moment these guys came, he was easy to yield under that pressure. Otherwise, he would have known that I'm dead. If we should do this, we are dead. If God should judge us straight away, we're in trouble. Aaron should have known that straight away. So, but he had a spiritual problem. But we thank God. God is merciful. Yeah. God is merciful. That is why the Bible says his mercies are infinite. Yeah. There is no way his mercies endureth forever and ever. The Bible says, though your sins be as scarlet, no matter how terrible it might be, the mercy of God when he calls back. That's the reason why God could say who is on the Lord's side. Moses could say that. Because somehow, intercession still worked for them. But the point we're making here is, we can see that they had a big, big problem. And their issues, the issues they faced, were actually fourfold. If we look at that term from verse 6, we can find there are actually four main problems they had. And before we talk about those main problems they had, the Gentile church here, the Corinthian church, were predominantly Gentile believers. A lot of them were Gentile believers. And they probably were not familiar with the history of the Israelites. I mean, Israel knew it. They would probably, but they were. So they had to bring all that out to let them know, look, you guys, do you remember in chapter 8, they had all sorts of issues in the Corinthian church at that time. All sorts of things you can imagine. And one of the things they were facing then, that they were actually trying to endorse eating food that was being sacrificed to idols. And Paul had to spend a whole chapter, I think chapter 7 or chapter 8, trying to tell them, look, even for conscience sake, what about that weak believer that comes in and sees you eating something that the Corinth was actually infested with idolatry. Oh, and you were saved now, and they find you eating the food sacrificed to them. Don't you think that's an issue? So Paul had to spend some time. They were kind of, they felt they were knowledgeable. They felt they were wise and wanted to justify every action. And Paul had to bring them in. So he was trying to warn them, look, don't feel you are wise. These other people tried to play God. They tried to think they were wise. Imagine what they were doing when they said, Aaron, let's make other gods for us. And look at what they did. They said they were offering burnt offerings and all the different offerings. They were, in one way, simulating Egypt, what the things they've learned in Egypt. And in another way, they were trying to pretend that they were actually worshiping God too. So there and then, they were kind of carving out a religion. Although God wanted to relate them in a way that God prescribed, but they were kind of trying to change it to suit the way they wanted. And that's not God's way.
No.
They wanted to do something that will accommodate the lust of their flesh, the lust of their eyes. The Corinthian church, sometimes these things come from a bit of selfishness, for example. Christianity is about selflessness. The moment, the whole thing about being selfish, the me factor goes away. The moment you feel you're a bit important before God and you want to do something and try and kind of rationalize it with God, you're already a candidate for the enemy to bring other things in. I'm sure their problem didn't start with sexual immorality. Other things started and that followed. It always starts with something, and it was warning them. Look, when you do that, God, you think that's the beginning. That little bit of rebellion, that little bit of not wanting to do will lead to all sorts of things. And that's the problem they had. Imagine, they started with, okay, where's this mother? Let's make up this. And the next day, they were into all kinds of nasty dances and things like that, which they had. The Bible says they were lusting after Egypt. All the time, all through. First Corinthians wasn't focusing just on what we did in Sunday school. They were actually expanding it through those many years they were in the wilderness. Many, many things happened. If we go to verse 7, neither ye be idolaters, as were some of them. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. If you should unpack those verses, just that verse in itself, they rose, ate and drank, they're already in the flesh. They were already just kind of there. And they began to do things that were unseemly.
Yeah.
Things that you could hardly imagine. They allowed that little wedge about not wanting to focus on God. Not wanting to relate to God. Now, they now blamed it on Moses. But really, their heart was already faulty.
Yeah.
They just felt that at least we can give that excuse. It's like you can blame it on, perhaps maybe someone makes a mistake. You blame it on that to be able to do what you want to do. That isn't the problem. The problem is you've been kind of piggybacking. You've just been striding along. You've just been struggling. And the moment someone makes a little bit of an error out of place, that gives you the chance. Off you go. And that would be the excuse to do. May God help us to see God as God and relate to him how he wants us to relate to him.
Amen.
Now, neither let us commit fornication as some of them committed and fell in one day 320,000. It was saying that, look, maybe that hasn't happened to you, Corinthian church. You know, when the house of Chloe came to give all the bad news about all sorts of things that were happening there. Maybe in the day of grace, God doesn't strike that way. But they're saying God hasn't changed. God, that same God of judgment, is still the same God today. Say, during that time, 23,000 perished in that punishment. And imagine this same children of Israel, the moment they came back, you know, we studied today. Yes, there, who is on the Lord's side? Many of them came again. But not too long, they started their murmurings again, didn't they?
Mm.
They started again. And we remember the rebellion Aaron and Miriam, when they actually complained about Moses again, that they're taking too much upon himself. Why all this? Why all that? Because to walk with God takes a focus on God.
Yeah.
To walk with God takes the stripping of the flesh. I mean, head knowledge is different from heart knowledge. The problem sometimes I feel we have in this dispensation is to gain head knowledge is not difficult. To be able to quote what the Bible or what this church stands for, it's not difficult. If you just need, you've been in this church for 5 years, 10 years, not 15, 20, 25, you can almost be you can theologize the whole gospel. But that is not it. That can be just head knowledge. Heart knowledge is what produces fruit. The reason why the Bible says, by their fruit ye shall know them. The reason why the Bible wasn't so much hung up about by your kind of knowledge of the scripture. It's good. There's nothing wrong in that. We need that. But when there is no applied knowledge, it's useless to God. Israel knew the Bible. They knew it. They knew, you know, the Pharisees that we all condemn, they were people who were the custodians of religion. They knew the whole Bible. They knew it. But because Jesus Christ, I can see through every heart, began to reveal their true heart condition and said, look, You're just white as sepulchres. You know that you look outside on the external, but your inside is full of rotting bones. He said you go length and breadth to make one proselyte. Proselytes means those who make them to come to be, you know, to learn of the God of Israel. Imagine saying we do everything, evangelism, go everything, do everything. But they say we end up making that person a twice of the child of hell than ourselves. What he's simply saying is you've ended up, by the time that person studies your life or gets closer to you, gets closer to your own circle of influence, after 1 year, 2 years, when they feel that all the fear factor when they first got saved is not this, is that it, then they begin to live anyhow. They say you make them twice the child of hell than yourself. That's what it means. So we in this dispensation, the reason why the Bible didn't use too much of object lessons anymore is let me open it up to them. Let it be straight through so that we can focus on reality. The gospel is reality.
Yes.
The gospel is about, you know, what really stems out of your life. Honestly, you know, I can stand here and preach the whole and claim the whole thing. If those fruits are not there, the Bible said he's not pleased. And we will not make the portals of glory. So let's not pride only. There's nothing wrong. I mean, forever I will appreciate this church and I will ever sing its praises. I'm not saying we shouldn't do that. We should. But that is just a springboard to taking advantage of that direct relationship with God. That is what's going to produce the real thing. The Israelites had some real issues. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted and were destroyed of serpents. Imagine this. They tempted, they just said, they became fed up again. Why this kind of wilderness experience? This is too much. What kind of life is this? Of relying on God all the time. Remember, the problem the Israelites had, if you go and analyze it very carefully, the things to do with day-to-day life. They were not stealing. Did you say that they went to steal money?
No.
It was just lack of faith. The real problem that landed them into all this was because they couldn't tune in into the way God wanted to walk with them. They just didn't want that. They tuned in into what our natural flesh wants. Naturally. That's why if you go to if you have a secular discussion on some of these scriptures, people will just be imagining, why condemning them? If you bring it to today's kind of way of thinking, you will say, what have they done wrong? They haven't done anything wrong. They were just feeling, you know, there's a limit to which you can. Why could you take, why taking them to the wilderness to start with? Why having to then cry to God all the time before you have food? But as God was then showing his miracles, when the Bible says man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word, trusting him, they kept running into these problems. And those problems will be one to the other. You know, when you don't see something, you begin to murmur. When certain things you don't understand, it will be complaining, isn't it? The Bible says, do all things without murmurings or complaining. It's only the spiritual man that can do that.
Yes.
If you are not completely sold out, no matter the knowledge, I can say that I have the knowledge, but if I'm not completely yielded to God, I will complain, I would murmur. It's as simple as that.
Yeah.
God wanted to make Israel as an example of how people can walk with him.
Mm-hmm.
How people can walk with him, to walk close with him. And that was where. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. He was telling the Corinthian church there that, look, if you think you stand, you're trying to use your brain to rationalize and feel if there's nothing wrong in eating the food with idols, sacrifice to idols. That was the problem. They were almost justifying everything they were doing. Doing all sorts of nonsense, justifying it. And he said, if you think you stand, take heed, though. The Israelites, they thought they were wise. Look at the result. It's all there in black and white in history. History has recorded it. See that. Be careful. And then the other thing, which is very, very amazing, verse 13, which I actually, God ministered to me about, said, there hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way of to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. Brethren, have you taken time, if you contextualize this, imagine the discourse all the way through, and he's saying, look, it's like the Israelites, if you feel there's no food, it's a temptation, it's true, it's hardship, but there's no temptation that is beyond God helping you out. That's what he's simply saying. No matter what you're going through, no matter what I'm going through, God is saying there is no temptation that is not common. Yeah. No matter how you can voice out, no matter how you can explain what, if you go way back in history, church history, there's been many that have happened that way, and some people have had the victory.
Amen.
Yes. That is the point here, that there's no temptation, nothing. None of us can be justified because his grace is sufficient.
Amen.
His grace is sufficient.
Amen.
That is the reason. You know, the Bible, you know, when he said, being born again, not of a corruptible seed, the things that caused Israel to do what? Because the seed, you know, were by nature were corruptible. But when you're born of the Spirit, a seed that is incorruptible is planted there.
Yeah.
That is the seed that enables us to live a life above sin.
Yeah.
That is the seed that enables us to be able to demonstrate the fruit of the Spirit.
Yeah.
That's the seed that when it grows and it's nurtured, that enables us to have long suffering. You know what long suffering means? That you're suffering but for a long time. It's not easy. People are making your life difficult, making almost hell like you, but you're not murmuring, you're not complaining, you're just committing your life to God.
Yeah.
Say, God, have your way. The sweet beauty of Christ is still flowing.
Yeah.
What people can see is just the beauty of Christ. Mm-hmm. Nothing more than that. But if other things are coming out, we are back to the level of the flesh. The Bible says we are then carnal. We can't please God. You can't, when you are back to, you're blaming this, blaming that, you're doing this, doing that, you haven't risen to that realm where there's victory, the realm of the Spirit, that realm where the true victory is, where nothing, you know, when that song says, storms do not alarm me, they sometimes must cease. It truly meant they don't alarm him, because he was operating in a realm, he was completely sold out to God, completely yielded to God, allowing, not because there are two things existing in us all the time. There is a natural honor, there's a spiritual honor. They will both be fighting each other. The Bible says the flesh and the spirit war against each other. If you don't recognize that in you, or I don't, the enemy will floor us. The reason why someone asks me that, why, how can you convince someone that they need for prayer? I know that if I don't mortify the flesh, my natural honor will predominate.
Yes.
And when it predominates, the works of the flesh will come out. And if I'm not even careful, before it gets to that stage, all the salvation over time, the whole thing will go out.
Yeah.
I will just become a professor and not a possessor. The difference between possessing and professing is the much spiritual work we do consistently, continually. And that is evidenced by people. People, we are not the one to endorse ourselves. Oftentimes, and most of the time, we feel we are nothing. We feel, we just see our inadequacy. We always see how much rubbish is inside us. But it's people that will then begin to see that beauty. Even as we are crushed, even as things not palatable come through our way, as we are crushed, as we then yield to God and commit our lives to him, to say, God, you know that songwriter which says that, deal with me as thou seest meet. He said, let sorrow do its work. Send grief and pain. Sweet are their messengers. Sweet their refrain. Because you've transcended beyond the realm here into the realm of the Spirit. Into the realm where God can supply abundance of grace. Into the realm whereby so other people will be going through that in the world, that we can let them know that Christ is the answer.
Yes.
Because they've seen you, they've seen what's gone through in your life, they've seen your situation, that maybe there's some kind of awkward situations that they've known about, but how are you surviving? What level of, how, where the grace came from for you to be able to live an abundant life? They will want to follow your God.
Yeah.
That is what Christianity is all about. That is the kind of relationship that God wanted to establish with Israel. Unfortunately, Joshua and Moses enjoyed that relationship. The rest did not. Nothing moved Moses. Whether the whole thing would come down, he would just say, God, look at your people, Lord. This is what they're saying. And God would send him a message because he was in that realm. And in this time and age, that is where all of us, the privilege we have is even greater than the privilege Moses had. We have a direct contact, but are we utilizing it? Are we allowing God to really have his way in our lives so that the beauty of Christianity can come in. The big question is, are we really living a life pleasing to God? Are we really? What's our benchmark? Is our benchmark comparing one with the other? The Bible says they that compare themselves with each other are not wise. But when we compare ourselves with the perfect law of liberty, when we use the Bible as our benchmark, when we read the words in this and the Bible says be blameless, and you say, God, I know I'm not blameless. Say to be unblameable. And God, and you can say, God, truly I am not, but your grace is sufficient. Yes. Then we're on the right track. And I think God wants to spend some time with him. These things were written to us as examples upon the whom the ends of the world have come. Shall we come to the altar to pray as we sing the closing song? More love to thee, O Christ.
Heavenly Father, we thank you. Thank you for the word of life you sent to us. Thank you for the word of wisdom you've sent to us. Thank you for the word of love you have sent to us. Oh Lord, come and minister into our souls this afternoon. As we go on our knees to prayer, give us that love, oh Lord, that will magnify you more than anything else in this world. Thank you, Father, because you will help us and do more than we ask. For we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.